Hello friends, my name is Shivam from DevOps Schools and I will help you to enable your learning process in various technologies of DevOps, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data and many more. This is our initiative to help you by sharing multiple tutorials and videos. And if you want any specific tutorials on any particular topic, then please do comment in the below comment section and I will help you with it. Also, please subscribe to our premium services on YouTube, which will give you access to more content and videos to enhance your knowledge about all these topics. Also, if you want me to help you with regards to the online trainings and classroom sessions by our qualified trainers, then please write me at contact@devopschool.com. Thank you.
Okay, now this is created. Now I want to create a volume out of it. So create volume and this is 1B, right? My instance is in 1B. And say Okay, so from the snapshot, now I will go and attach it to my running instance. Attach. Okay, so let me go here. Let me go to, so this is the one. Now this got attached. Now I need not have to, so I'll just make it online and then it will, it has got data already, right? So I need not have to format it or anything. So if I go to E drive, this is my file. Okay, let's test it. Fine.
Okay. So will you show that image concept next when we will show image concept?
Which one?
Image concept.
I'm going to show it now. Okay. So this is basically the concept of a snapshot. So this is the use case when you want to take a backup, point in time backup of your volume. Now there is another concept.
I have one question. So you attach with that in at the running machine, right? Like, is it possible in Linux in running machine we can attach?
Yeah, you can.
Okay, but we have to follow the steps whatever you have provided, right? So to attach.
So when you are restoring from a snapshot and creating a volume, then MKFS is not required. Just take that device name and mount it.
Okay.
Yeah. New volume. Okay,
anything important like the key points while we are doing this? Any is there any key points important? Like maybe your experience. Maybe you'll if you're interviewing someone, which type of questions you ask under this?
So key points in a sense, what, like, I'm not getting.
In my last interview, I got question, I told you. So it's a one, the critical server is running web server. So without any downtime, will you take replica of that or not? Like that, is there any important questions?
Important questions are like, you have to be always in the same zone. So what will happen if you create a volume in another availability zone? Can you attach it?
You can't, right?
You can't. Right. So what is the remedy? That is one question. You're facing interview or what?
No, I'm not facing any interview. Just
You are
no,
taking
I'm
interview notice.
actually I'm
Not
trying to
actually.
take this architect certification, so I'm asking for that only.
Okay. Fine, fine. I'll guide you how to tackle these things.
Okay,
On the
sure.
last day, I will give
Okay.
you some tips.
Okay,
I thought
sure. Thank you.
when you asked to somebody when you are
No,
interviewing
like
someone.
actually, no, I'm not taking any interview. Why? Because I recently joined in Fidelity. Okay.
Okay.
It's been
Got you.
only
Yeah.
3 months only. It's been only three
Okay.
months.
Fine. No worries. Fine. So you got this snapshot concept, right? Now let us go to the image, AMI. So snapshots are basically used for creating a copy of a volume. Now this same concept is expanded to image. If you want the whole server, you want to create a Amazon machine image, you can do that. So if you go to the EC2 instance, which is running, review my instance, and if I go to image, I can create an image. So it will take everything. Whatever are the additional volumes which are attached to this, it will take it in total. So there is, you here, if I don't want this additional volume, I can just delete them. And it will take only the root. And suppose if I say, image. Now here, so answering your question, no reboot. So if you click this I, this answer lies here. So when enabled, EC2 does not shut down the instance before creating the image. When this option is used, file system integrity on the created image cannot be guaranteed. So this is very logical. If there are updates happening on your instance and you are taking a image, then naturally it will be an inconsistent image. So best practice here is let it reboot one time. So when you create an image, it just takes some couple of seconds, maybe a few seconds, and it
But
will come up.
without reboot also we can create, right?
You can, but see, this is a server, and so there are heavy updates happening on the disk. Now, when you take a snapshot, ultimately image is what underlying it is the snapshot. So if you have taken the image and after that there is update, so that will not be captured, right? So it's
Correct, correct.
better to reboot it once. So that you will have the perfect copy. So maybe do it when the load is not there or at night time somewhere and create an image.
So update means I didn't get that part. Update
Update
means
means
we are
see, you are running a server. Suppose it is
okay.
some server, file server, database server, whatever. And users are using it. They are updating some file blocks on the server through some application. So XYZ application is running and people are writing something to the disk. Now you go and create an image at one point in time. So once the block is copied to the snapshot or image, there is an update happening on the block. So that will not be captured, no? Correct?
Got it.
So yeah, so you'll not get consistent data image. Fine. So let me create this image. So once you create an image, it will start appearing under AMI. So this is the image that is getting created. Okay. So underlying this thing, it uses the same technique as that of snapshot. Only thing is image will capture everything, and from this image you can directly create a EC2 instance. So what is the use case of this AMR? So suppose you have taken a plain vanilla image, say Amazon Linux. Linux, and on that you have installed Apache Server, you have installed Tomcat, you have installed some MySQL, whatever software suit, and your application. So everything you have installed, it you have taken a plain vanilla AMI and installed everything. Now you need 10 such servers. So every time you need not have to repeat this process. What you can do, once you install it, create an image. And from this image, you can create the servers, create the EC2 instances. Okay, so it saves you a lot of work. Okay.
Actually, I take an image of Windows machine. Is it possible to create in Linux?
No, how you can do that? Create in Linux means?
No, first of all, actually my web server is Linux machine. Okay, I take an image of that. Can I create can I create a Windows machine with that same properties? We can't, right?
No, you can't.
Okay.
So these are the AMIs. Now, if I click here and take action, I can launch instance. So it will come up with all that softwares which are already installed. Okay. So that is the use of AMR. Fine. Now let me show you another thing. So when I launched the instance, every time we used the quick start. What do you mean by quick start? So there are certain images which are already listed. So if I go to quick start, these are some of say 40 images which are frequently used images which are there. There is something called as a community AMI. So the AWS community, there are a lot of users and they keep on creating different software combinations and create them as an image, and these are available to you. So anytime, suppose you want to create for MySQL, you'll find one's image already there. So there will be some lot of images with MySQL. So WordPress with MySQL on Windows. So there are different combinations you will find in this community images. Okay. So instead of doing everything from scratch, you can just search for your combination. You will get one some images which are already there. So that is a community AMI. You can always create your image and submit it to community, and it will be used by other users. Now there is something called as a AMI ID. So now this is the ID, AMI ID, and it is specific to this region. So if you go to another region, say Ohio region, and look for Amazon Linux AMI, the content will be same, but the ID will be different. Okay, so ID are unique to the region. Now, another thing is AWS Marketplace. Now, what is this? Is basically there are number of software vendors. They have kept their product as AMIs. Okay, so for example, Meta. Yes, an example. So Cloud Volumes ONTAP server, which is very, very popular. Now this will act as a AMI. So once you create the EC2 instance using this AMI, it will act as an ONTAP server. Okay, so there are various products from NetApp which are available, or if you go to Cisco, there will be some products from Cisco VH, Cloud Router, That's it. So these are basically EC2 instances that will be running and with that software running on them. So there are many vendors. They give their products as AMIs. Of course, there is a charge for that. There is a software charge per hour, or it could be a BYOL. So the BYOL means bring your own license. So if you have already purchased this product in-house and now you want to take it to cloud, you can always talk to these vendors and they will give you the code and you can install it here. Yeah, so there are various licensing mechanisms in AWS. Yeah. So this is another place where you have a lot of AMIs from vendors. Yeah.
Srikanth, we have created a AMI in the North Virginia, right? So will it be reflecting in the Ohio?
You have to copy that. So there is an option to copy to another region and you can do that.
Okay, how so
do it in my account. I will show you the process, okay. But okay. Don't do it here.
Okay.
Go to AMIs. So this will appear, your AMIs will appear here.
Okay.
So this is my AMI. And copy it. So then we select the destination region. So region you select and then copy it. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
So there it will appear as an AMI. You can launch an instance from there.
Okay. Fine.
Any questions on this topic, snapshots and images? Okay. Fine. So snapshots, keep this in mind. Snapshots are only supported on EBS volumes. It is not supported on instance store volumes. So if you are using the server with an instance store volume, you need to have some different kind of mechanism to back the data up. You can use your own tools or at a file level, you can take a backup. Okay. So snapshot is a tool which is available on only on EBS.
And snapshots are stored in S3, right?
S3 storage.
Okay.
Anyways, we will store the image.
Pardon me?
What about images? Images is like a snapshot will
yeah,
store,
yeah. They are also stored in S3.
Okay.
Okay, I think so. Please, we are not going to need this service. So please terminate them. Please delete the volumes, images, and snapshots what you have created. See, remember there is a heavy billing coming to me. So please don't keep it running whenever you don't need it. Okay? If you need it, I can always give it to you. But whenever you don't need it, just terminate them. So that will save some money. So please terminate all your servers and please delete the additional volumes what you have created and also the snapshots and images. So images, when you go to AMIs, you need to deregister them. So go here and deregister them. And then go to snapshot and so delete this image. Emma Odile? I don't see any response. Okay, let us move to the next service, that is S3, simple storage service. Now, a simple storage service is basically a standalone storage. So you can compare that service with maybe Google Drive or Dropbox kind of storage. But it's S3 is very, very popular because of its scalability and availability. Now, when we talk about S3, there are different storage classes, and depending upon the availability and durability you need, you get different classes. So if you are okay with less durable storage and less available storage, you will come at a cheaper price. But if you want very high performance, basically availability and durability, then there are those classes also. S3 storage is basically a file storage. So you can upload objects or files and you can download files. S3 storage cannot be directly attached to a EC2 instance, but it can be used as a folder. So if you want to copy data from say EC2 instance to S3 bucket, it is called as a bucket. Bucket is basically the basic container what you need to create when you start using S3 as a service. So what I'm going to show you is, this is my new account. So currently there are no buckets here. So if you go to the services under storage section, click on S3, and what I'm going to do, I'm going to create a bucket with a basic container in which you can upload files or you can create folders inside this bucket. Now, one thing you have to keep in mind is the bucket name has to be unique across available, across the AWS namespace. So suppose if I try to give a very generic name, test, and try to create the bucket, it will say the bucket name already exists. So the name has to be unique. So with different combinations of the name, maybe fidelity will also be existing, I don't know. So let me create a bucket with fidelity, dash fidelity. And yeah, so this is a unique name. So I'm just trying to create a bucket, and these are certain properties of that bucket. So we'll deal with it. We will just go ahead with these options currently. So I'll click next. This is related to the permissions, public access permissions on the bucket. Currently, I'm going to uncheck it. Okay. And so it will ask me to acknowledge this. So I will just create, go to next and create a bucket. Fine. So as a normal account, what is the limitation in terms of buckets? As a normal account, you can create 100 buckets. Okay. And is there any limitation on how many files you can store in a bucket? Well, there is no limitation. You can store, it is whatever number of files you want to upload, you can do that. Is there any limitation on the file size? Yes, currently the limitation is 5 TB. So the file cannot exceed 5 TB in size.
Hello.
Okay, so those are the any question? Okay. So this is the bucket I have created. Now the bucket gets created in one of the regions. So currently it is in US East North Virginia region. But here if you see, the view is global. So when you go to S3, the view is global. That means if I create a bucket in any other region also, it is visible here, which is not the case with EC2 console. EC2, you see only EC2 instances in that particular region. So S3, the view is global. So view is global doesn't mean the service is global. You are still, service is global in the sense it is a region specific service. So when you create a bucket, it will get created in one of the regions.
So it's not like IAM, right? It's not like IAM. IAM is a global service. It's not a global service.
It is not a global service. It is a region service. Okay. Now let me.
Can we view different regions, S3 bucket in this region? That's what it means.
Yeah, you can create in any region, and that will be shown here in this global view.
Okay.
Like any restriction to bucket size, like it should be 100 pb or something. Is there any restrictions, limitation?
No. There is no limit on the bucket size. There is only limit on the file size.
Five petabyte. Okay.
And number of buckets in a normal, if you are using a normal account, then it is 100 buckets. Always, this is a soft limit. You can always talk to support and get it extended.
Normal account means?
Normal account means you and me create an account. So that will be 100 buckets you can create. And then you, if you want more, then you need to raise a ticket and they will increase it for
you. Okay. Got it.
Okay. Now let me click this. Now I want to upload a file. So let me just go ahead and make this numbers. Just upload one sample file. Index. Some file, it is just containing some characters. There is no HTML format. I'm just naming it, and then I will just upload it. So when I upload it, these are the storage classes what I was referring to. So standard storage class, this will give you very high availability and durability. So in the backend, the data will be copied across availability zones. So if any availability zone fails within a region, you will not lose data. Then, so it is highly available and highly durable. So durability is mentioned in terms of nines, and it is called 11-9 durability for standard storage class. So how do you measure durability? Durability of 11-9 means if I upload 10^11 files, there is a chance that one file may get lost. That is what is meant by 11-9 durability. So it's a very durable and highly available storage. Now there are different storage classes. So intelligent tiering. So what happens is long-lived data with changing or unknown access patterns. So what will happen is if you have uploaded an object and you are not accessing it frequently.
To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the 3D99 plan and grow your skills immensely.
So what the AWS will do is if it is not accessed frequently, it will move to another storage class for a possibly, this is another class, standard infrequent access class. So the objects which are not accessed very frequently will be moved to this class. So this will be built little less compared to standard storage class. Okay. So there are various classes depending upon what kind of access, how many times you access it, or depending upon the availability and durability you want. So one is this access, intelligent tiering, then standard infrequent access, one zone IA. One zone means the data will not be replicated to another zone. So definitely the availability is hampered very seriously. If the zone goes down, you will have a downtime. It is not that the file is lost, but you will have a downtime. Then there are archive type of storage classes, for example, Glacier and Glacier Deep Archive. So what are these type of storage classes is, in a data center environment, the backup person takes the backup on tapes and he moves it to offsite, right? So whenever you need a particular file, the person will go and take a particular tape, put it in the tape drive, and you can restore it. So the data is available somewhere, but it is not online. So it's the same concept. So Glacier storage class, once you put the file in the Glacier storage class, it is not online. It is not immediately available. When you need it, you raise a request, not through support ticket, but there is a, you can do it through console, and then this data will be restored back to your bucket. Now, how much time it will take, whether that will depend upon, there are various retrieval classes. If you want it to be retrieved very quickly, then you'll have to pay some additional charges. So that is why it says ranging from minutes to hours. So there are different time limits, how fast you can restore this data. So that is Glacier storage class. And another one is Glacier Deep Archive. So you are basically archiving the data and you don't need it for a longer period. So you just keep it. For example, say India, say if you're keeping telephone records, now it is a mandate that for 5 years you need to keep the CDR records. So for those kind of scenarios, you need data, but it need not be online. So in that case, you can use Glacier storage class or Deep Archive class. Then the another one is reduce redundancy. Now this is getting deprecated slowly. First it was introduced. So the performance wise, it is similar to standard storage class, but this is reduced redundancy, but it is not replicated across availability zones. Okay. So that is how it is. So these are different storage classes depending upon your requirement. The pricing will also vary.
Sorry to interrupt you. For standard, they mentioned the minimum storage duration. So
yeah,
it means we can put for 1 day or 2 hours.
Yeah,
it's like,
So you will be built per GB. Go ahead.
Okay. For the intelligent tiering, it should be 30 days at least, right?
Yeah. So once you upload it, minimum for 30 days you will be billed.
Oh, minimum for 30 days. Okay, got
yes,
it.
Yes.
Okay, got it.
So there is no limitation like that on standard storage class. Whenever you delete it, you will be billed on a per GB per month basis. So for whatever duration it is there, that only will be billed. Okay.
In standard, will they charge for 30 days or they didn't mention that for 30 days, right? It's for minute, right?
No, they charge it on a per GB per month basis. Suppose per if month you use it for...
Go ahead.
So if you upload an object and if you keep it for 1 hour and the size is 5 GB, okay, then they will calculate per GB per month cost. So in a month, how many hours are there? So 1 hour divided by those many hours. So that will be per hour cost, like that. Okay. So actually it is per GB per month. That is how they build.
So means I want to store my data for one day, okay? So but they will calculate for 30 days by default.
So suppose right? There, right, so per GB per month, if the dollar, the charge is $1.
Okay,
now you are putting 1 GB file for 1 hour, right? So 1 hour comes to how many months? That they will calculate.
Okay,
and that much they will charge.
Okay, got it.
So this is basically, I will go with the defaults. Okay, so this will be refreshed. Now this is my file which I have uploaded. Now if I click this, now I am at a file level and I get a URL. So this is my URL. Now by default, when a object gets uploaded, it is a private object. So if I click this link, I will get a access denied error. So my, I don't have access. Now this is, this it is using as no user on AWS. It is a generic access from any browser. So that is why I'm getting access denied error. Okay. If I want to make it public, I can do that. So I will make it public and then now I can access it. Okay, so since my file is named as HTML, it is showing it in the browser. If the file is say PDF file, it will open in the plugin will open in the browser and show that file. Okay, so now suppose if I go here, so it depends upon what type of file it is. Suppose if I upload another file.
Sorry to interrupt you. Sorry, can you please upload that URL, your Google URL here? That will be helpful.
Google URL will not help here. The Excel sheet, Google sheet.
Yeah, that Google you ask sheet, to no? update in future, right?
No, yeah, correct. But no, that will not help you. The purpose there is different. Like online, okay. You can update. that facility is not.
There is no link to with me. That's why I'm asking.
Acha, link. Okay.
Yeah, that I'm can. Able to access that. Okay.
Okay, I'll do that. Some technical analysis master class. It is there. Upload it.
So suppose if we create a folder within this particular right, so using the link we can navigate till that folder and see the file, like view the file, like all those things.
Yeah.
Like we use any other repository, right?
You can. Yeah, you can. You mean the which tool you will use?
No, suppose like instead of directly creating in the instead of directly creating that file in the bucket, you make a folder and create it inside that, right? So yeah, can we using this thing, can we navigate and like
okay. Yes,
it's like same Google Docs, right? Whatever he shared just now, it's like same. That depending upon URL what you share.
Correct. Okay. And there are some third-party tools also, which will allow you to, browse it. So S3 browser is a third-party tool. Of which it will give you a good GUI and you can just drag and drop your files. So that is possible. But in a native console, it is not like that. So this is the file. Now this was a PDF file. So the plugin opened in the browser. Okay. So coming to your So here I can create a folder.
So one more question. So if in case you create the, make it as public, right? Like you would not require any kind of authentication to kind of call it as an API or something, right? Like if required.
No.
Otherwise, if like you would public, require something like AMS or something.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Right. So that depends on the permissions what you give at object level.
Okay, so you would be covering that part as well, right? KMS and all those things.
KMS to a degree we will cover, yes. That is a part of IAM actually, and resource policies that we are going to cover in detail.
Okay.
So this is the link, and so there are certain properties here. At an object level. Now I am at object level, so many minimum properties will be there. One is this class, which we when we uploaded object, we selected that. There is an encryption. So data at rest can be encrypted. Now there are two ways to encrypt this file. One is from the AES-256 S3 server side encryption, as it is called. So if I enable this, it is a symmetric key encryption, and the key will be managed by AWS. Okay, so if I do that, it will just keep it as encrypted file. Okay, now there is another option, that is there is a separate service called as key management service, in which there will be a master key and there will be data keys that will be generated, and the data keys will be used to encrypt the data. So there is another service here. So we will see that in maybe day after tomorrow. So advantage of this is in the KMS, you can actually create your own customer master key. And you don't depend on the AWS generated keys. You can have your own key. And from that, the data key will be generated. So there are these three options. Either you have unencrypted data, or you can use the server-side encryption, which AWS will manage these keys. Or if you want to have your own customer master key, you can take it there. Okay, you can take it from here. So this is how the data at rest can be encrypted. And data in transit is encrypted because if you see at the link, it is always HTTPS link. So it is always a secured connection. By default. Let me come back to this. Let's again properties. So this is encryption. Metadata is basically it will find out the type of the file. And if you click here, you will see that content type is text. If it is a PDF, it will say Adobe type document like that. Tags are again, so just like your key value pairs, you can name these objects. So if you are working in a project and if you have a naming convention for certain objects, you can tag them. Object lock is actually a setting at the bucket level, which currently we have disabled. And if you enable it, public access is disabled for the any of the objects in the bucket. That is where we have disabled. Permissions. So access for object owner. Now I have created the bucket, I have created the object, so I am the owner of this bucket. Okay. Now every user, when you create an account on AWS, that is called as a root account. And every account has got what is called as a canonical ID. And this is my canonical ID. Now, suppose I want to give access to another account, then I can add that account here. So I need to give either the email address or my canonical ID. And that person can access this object. Okay. So these are certain permissions you can give at a object level. And third one is the public access. So I have now given everyone access. So this is the access read object and read object permissions. So currently I have given those permissions. This is related to will not be going into these details. This comes under the developer part. So here you can, if your file is in a particular format, CSV, JSON kind of a format, then you can run some queries on this. So that is, this works with a tool called Amazon Athena. And if you have a raw data, which is a comma separated file or in a JSON format, you can create certain regular expressions and you can query this data. So that is from this select now. Okay, so these are the things which are available at a file level or object level. Now the interesting things are at a bucket level. So let me go to bucket. So I'm at a bucket level now. So let me go to properties. So first property here is versioning. So I can enable versioning on a bucket. So versioning, how it appears is, suppose I have a file index.h or some XYZ file I have uploaded. Now, after some time I have updated that file, I've made some changes and again I upload it. So usually what happens, the file will get overwritten, right? But I don't want I don't want to overwrite. I want to keep the previous versions also. So if I enable versioning, the earlier versions will also be kept. So this is where it is used. This prevents accidental deletion. Somebody accidentally deletes it, then at least you have the old version. Okay. So there it is used. Server access logging. So where it is used in a corporate environment, there are various users, they access the bucket and we want to log what request was sent by which user. Anyway, I can enable this server access logging, and if I enable it, it will keep the logs in a particular bucket. So this is a target bucket and target prefix, and then so this is my target bucket, and target bucket means where it will keep the logs. So this is my original bucket, Srikanth Fidelity. I can select another bucket and there the logs will be kept. Static website hosting. This is a very good feature. If you want to host static website, not the dynamic website. So static website means if your web page consists of only HTML, CSS and JavaScript files, client side scripts, then you can use this feature, static website hosting. So if you use this bucket, for example, then I can give the name index.html. So you need to upload these, all those CSS and all files, and then it will act as a website. Okay. So this will be the URL that will be used. Okay. And you need to upload those files under those proper folders, CSS, JavaScript, etc. It will act as a static website. You don't need a server here if it is a static website.
So, one quick thing, Srikanth. So, in case we are using the static site, right? Like, can we use our API gateway to kind of call it and use it inside AWS?
API gateway is usually used for dynamic.
Okay, dynamic, so again, we cannot use static for that if required.
No, usually, see, API gateway will send a get request or a post request or a put request, right? And the backend has to respond with a dynamic page. So there I don't think it will be useful because this is for purely static.
Okay. Okay.
So this is now
then,
object
then it will help. Sorry, interview. This static website will helpful to like e-books, right? If you have any e-book, so then you can upload here, you can share the URL. That's better, right?
Yeah, right. So don't need a server. Just it will be in a website format. Mm-hmm. You will be able to see everything. See, usually on the blog or this thing, you need a server, right? So here, no, you don't need a server. You put it in a proper folder, CSS, JavaScript, etc., and HTML. It will be a full-fledged static website.
Yes, yes.
Object-level logging. So there is another service called as a Cloud Trail. And so what happens is when you interact with AWS, you can interact it with AWS in three ways. One is the console, what we have been doing so far. Another thing is AWS CLI, that is command line interface. So you download that tool and you can run commands. Or third is SDK. So if you are a programmer, you can use Java SDK, Python SDK, etc., and you can interact with AWS. So whatever method you use to interact, what is actually happening in the background is APIs are getting called. And what this CloudTrail service does is it will capture those APIs. So where it is used, it is basically used for auditing purpose. So suppose there are some users are using console, some users are using CLI, some are using SDK. No matter what tool they use, it is actually executing APIs at the backend. So that is the CloudTrail, that is the service, and you can track what is happening in your account. Okay? So that is object level logging. So this was server access logging. So that is at a bucket level. And so if somebody is uploading an object in a bucket or downloading an object, that will be tracked here. Here actually it's a object level logging you can do by using CloudTrail. Okay. Then you have default encryption. So again, this is at a bucket level. We have seen this at a file level. So same concept. If you apply it at a bucket level, all objects will be encrypted under that bucket. Object lock we have discussed. Tags, again, you can give a key value pair for the tags. Then you have transfer acceleration and events. So what is transfer acceleration? Now what happens is, suppose you are uploading a very large file, say some GBs. So what happens is, what you can do is a multi-part upload. So multi-part upload is possible only through command line. Basically, it will break the file into small pieces, and then it will upload it one by one. Once it gets uploaded to a S3 bucket, it will make one file. So this is a feature called multi-part upload. So if a large file is uploaded, it will use multi-part upload. But still, you are not happy with the speed at which it is getting uploaded. Then there is a feature called as transfer acceleration. So what will happen is, now we have discussed about regions, right? So regions, there are availability zones, and we can actually set up EC2 instances, etc. But apart from regions, there are called as edge location. There are some locations which are called as edge locations. So these are not directly accessible to a user, but some services use this edge locations. So one of the service which uses this edge location is CloudFront. So it is called CDN network, Content Delivery Network. So how it is used is basically it caches the static data. That is the basic purpose of edge location. So when you have some server, say located in US region, and my user is in India, and you have a website which is full of videos and say images. Now every time the India user goes to this website and streams a video, there will be a lot of latency. So how it is handled is all the static data will be pushed to the nearest edge location. So in near India, there will be some edge location. Maybe I'm from Pune, maybe in Bangalore, or maybe Mumbai also will be using. Mumbai is nearer to me, but maybe some locations in within India, there are edge locations. So they are not regions. They are edge locations used for caching static data. So all these videos will be cached here. And when I browse it, instead of going here, they will be streamed from here. Okay. So that is how these edge locations are used usually by CloudFront. The transfer acceleration feature uses it in a reverse way. It will basically, if you are trying to upload a file in a US, say East region, then it will first upload it to edge location. From edge location, it will go to the destination region. So if you are uploading large files, then there is a feature they have given it to you. Now again, if you are getting the improvement or not, it depends on many factors. One is the ISP speed, your end device, and the edge location and region, how many hops it takes, etc. So what they have done is they have given a tool to basically test. So if you go to this tool, it will upload from my laptop. So here it is shown, S3 direct upload speed, S3 accelerated transfer upload speed. So now it is trying to do it directly, and then it is through a edge location. So if you really get an improvement, then you can go for this feature. This feature comes at a cost. So they have given just a tool to basically verify you are getting a real speed advantage. So upload is complete now. I will try to do it with Cloud. Clearly said, uploading sample files to CloudFront endpoint. That means it is using edge location, which is nearer to me. So many a times, the direct may be faster. You never know. In this case, it is 14% improvement if I upload it to edge location. Okay. So this service comes at a cost. This is just a tool to verify if you are really getting the speed. Now in events, when you upload an object to the bucket, there is an event. Or when you download an object, there is an event. And on those events, certain things can be triggered. So for example, I have this S3 bucket, and somebody is, say, uploading an object here. Now suppose this is an image file, and what is the scenario here? Now suppose this is my EC2 instance, which is going to process this image and convert it into another format. So this is the scenario. Now the drawback in the scenario is every time this EC2 instance is going to poll if new file has been uploaded to S3, and then finally uploaded, it is going to basically process it. So instead of,
please enroll our general membership for $399 plan to get access of all the parts.
Along with that, you can access our other tutorials such as Docker, Ansible, Jenkins, Terraform, Splunk, AWS, Azure, and various other DevOps-related premium tutorials with our channel membership. If you would have any issues with our channel membership, you can drop an email to us at contact@devopschool.com, or you can also unsubscribe from channel membership anytime if you don't want to continue or did not like the video. To get our channel membership, click onto the join button, select the 399 plan, and grow your skills immensely.
Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries. We will reply to them at the earliest.
Thanks for watching.